Good morning and welcome to the Deanery Garden at Canterbury Cathedral on this Holy Monday, Monday of Holy Week, the 11th of April. Wherever you are in the world, please feel welcome and bring your own prayers and intentions. One of the great sentences of Jesus, walk in the light, and his I am statement, I am the light of the world. And the sign of the sun rising each morning is a sign which reminds us of that. And the sun this morning is rising behind the leafless ailanthus tree, the Chinese tree of heaven. So if you like, the light of the world is shining through the tree of heaven onto the earth below to give us encouragement to keep this Holy Week and to have our minds and our spirits and hearts set on anything that God wills for us, not only this week, but in the months ahead, our own journey. But let's continue to pray on this morning for the people of Ukraine, wherever they are in the world, and for all the terrible things that they have had to suffer, and also what seems to be intended as another attack on them. And we remember all those, not only those who've left their country and have sought shelter elsewhere, but those who are still facing the terrible conflict which is going on there. This is one dimension of our Holy Week prayers, and a very important one this morning. Behind me here, we've got a lovely array of bulbs, and the sun is beginning to touch them. The yellow of the daffodils and the blue of the muscari, the grape hyacinths, which are of course together the colours of the Ukraine flag. And then behind that, a lovely amelanchier, which is sometimes in full flower, sometimes called a snowy mespilus, or a juneberry, or a service berry. This one was planted in memory of our dear friend Robin Lee Pemberton, Lord Kingstown, who, if anyone deserved a service berry as a tree to remember him by, he was the Lord Lieutenant of Kent, the Governor of the Bank of England, and an immensely faithful servant of the church, and the chairman of the Cathedral Trustees here in total faithfulness. We remember his wife, Rose, this morning, and remember with enormous joy and thanksgiving the life of Robin as this amelanchier flowers on this spring morning. So let's begin our prayers, and there will be many themes this morning. One of them is a theme, as you'll see, which relates to cats. Well, we've got two of our friends here this morning, and they were all competing, or both competing, for a place in the camera. And so we've given them two different bowls in different places, and we'll see how that gets on. And our friend the robin is very much around at the same time, and also Corny Crow, who's just landed on a branch of the tree of heaven this morning. Everything is around this morning, and so that's a lovely thing as we begin our prayers on this Monday of Holy Week. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving power among the nations. Blessed are you, Lord God of our salvation. To you be praise and glory forever. As a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, your only Son was lifted up, that he might draw the whole world to himself. May we walk this day in the way of the cross, and always be ready to share its weight, declaring your love for all the world. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm on this 11th morning of the month is Psalm 57. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me. For my soul takes refuge in you. In the shadow of your wings will I take refuge, until the storm of destruction has passed by. I will call upon the Most High God, the God who fulfills his purpose for me. He will send from heaven and save me, and rebuke those that would trample upon me. God will send forth his love and his faithfulness. I lie in the midst of lions, people whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue a sharp sword. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and your glory over all the earth. They have laid a net for my feet, my soul is pressed down. They have dug a pit before me, and will fall into it themselves. My heart is ready, O God, my heart is ready. I will sing and give you praise. Awake, my soul, awake, harp and lyre, that I may awaken the dawn. I will give you thanks, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praise to you among the nations. For your loving kindness is as high as the heavens, and your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and your glory over all the earth. It's a wonderful psalm for this particular day. Be exalted. And as we praise God, those images of the psalmist of the creation all around us, high as the heavens, and the heavens stretching out in their blue simplicity today. But at the same time, the garden all around us beginning to flower. Yesterday afternoon, I led around, and it was a lovely, lovely occasion. I led around the garden in a group, many of the garden congregation from across the world who had come here to stay in the lodge for Holy Week. And it was a lovely thing to feel that they seemed to know everyone's name, like Tiger and Russell and Ducky and so on, before I even had to tell them. We walked about and rejoiced on a lovely afternoon in the garden. And so they were signs of all of you right across the world worshipping together. And they were here this morning earlier at morning prayer and crowded into the chapel of Our Lady Martyrdom. So we give thanks for people worshipping in all places from different lands. And we ourselves join our reflections now with theirs as we go back to... Now what I'm going to do is to read the next part of St. John's Gospel. And let me explain why. The Monday of Holy Week in St. Mark's Gospel gives us a definite story. In St. John's Gospel, it's rather different. And there is a conflict of dates and a conflict of days which happens between the three synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and the fourth Gospel of John. We've been going through John, and I'm going to continue to do that in the mornings of Holy Week, because it allows us a reflection about timing and the way the evangelists work to give their message, each utterly distinctive. And sometimes that message means there is a slight conflict, particularly in time and place. So I'm going to where we left off at chapter 13, and you remember that Jesus had gone away to hide himself and then came back and cried out, "Whoever believes in me believes not in me but in the one who sent me. And what I say as the Father has told me." That's where we left it on Saturday morning in John's Gospel. If I pick that up now in chapter 13, the very next verse, we find ourselves at the supper table with Jesus and his disciples. And I'll speak about that once I've read this passage. It's the passage of how Jesus showed the fact that he came not to be served, but to serve by a particular act at this supper table. It's an act that we normally associate with Maundy Thursday, and we shall do that in our liturgy. But for the moment, I'm in the fourth Gospel, and let's see how this story is told. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments and, taking a towel, tied it round his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped round him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but afterwards you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "That the one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not every one of you." For Jesus knew who was to betray him. That was why he said, "Not all of you are clean." When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than the master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I am not speaking of you all. I know whom I have chosen, but the scripture will be fulfilled. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. I am telling you this now before it takes place, that when it does take place, you may believe that I am he. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever receives the one I send receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me." So here is the scene at the supper as described by the evangelist of the fourth gospel, the, shall we call, the Johannine strand of the Apostle John, the son of Zebedee. And it's something that, as I said at the beginning, conflicts with that supper as told in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. For there, it is quite clearly in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Passover meal. And here, it is not. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it's quite clear, and we've read the passages so many times, where will you have us prepare the Passover? And so when they sit down to supper, it's the Passover meal, and the feast has already begun. And then the next day, Jesus is there, crucified on Passover day. But here is different. This is not the Passover. In fact, it's the eve, therefore the day has begun, of the day of preparation of the Passover. And the evangelist in this gospel makes that quite clear. It becomes very clear the next day when, after the betrayal and arrest, everyone is flying round trying to do things really fast so that everything will then be accomplished before the sun sets and Passover begins. This is quite different. Why is this so? And we can say why it's so in terms of signs, because this gospel is giving us a completely different sign about Jesus as he is crucified. For all that takes place on the day of preparation. And on that day, in the temple, inside the city wall, the Passover lambs are being slaughtered for the Passover feast the next day. And here, on the cross, the Lamb of God is being slaughtered, the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Here is the sign that the fourth evangelist is wanting to give us. Outside the holy city, on that bleak hillside, the Lamb of God is sacrificed as the ritual lambs of the preparation for the Passover are slaughtered in the temple. It's a very, very different image. And there are several images going on all the time in this. We know how the fourth evangelist loves images. And those present tense images, which from the things of creation, but also the things of humankind, in the way that in order to fix everything in their mind, we're always told that something that you are told, you can soon forget. And something that you say and hear, you can soon forget. But something that is done to you, in which you are a part, you don't forget. And so Jesus is absolutely sure that the message of service for those who are going to be the ones that he sends will be fast fixed into their minds, hearts, and bodies by a physical activity which causes them shock and total surprise. To wash people's feet at the beginning of a meal was not in any way a surprising thing, but it would be done normally by a servant of the household, or maybe one of the older children of the household who would come round and do that. I remember so many times going into households in Tanzania, in southern Sudan, of the first thing that happens is that a bowl of water is presented that you then wash your hands as a sense of a sense of being welcome to the household. Before anything else, this is presented. Before what do you want or what have you come for, this act of hospitality in hot and dusty times that would have been done for the feet as well. And our stoop in the cathedral, our water stoop, which was carved for us by Stephen Cox out of that lovely marble, which has not been in use because of the pandemic for some time, but is normally filled with lovely water, which covers the patterns of the marble and makes it look streamlike. And it's there so that people can feel a sign of refreshment and welcome. And many Christians dip their hands into it and make the sign of the cross in memory of what our Lord suffered, as this gospel is told. He took a bowl of water and he took off his outer garments and wrapped a towel, a sign of service, around his waist, and then knelt to wash their feet. We have a lovely icon in the ambulatory of the crypt, which stands back to back with the image of Our Lady of Canterbury, Our Lady Undercroft. But as people go round, they are confronted with this wonderful modern icon. It was blessed and consecrated only a couple of years ago. And it shows Peter's surprise and almost with withdrawal, because he feels himself unworthy of what's going on. And Jesus' face looking at him, and unlike most icons, they're looking at each other, not at us. And Peter is saying, he's pointing to his head, he's saying, not my feet only, my hands and my head. And Jesus is saying to him, you must allow me to wash you, but you don't need more than your feet washed, because this is, he doesn't say this, this is a sign of your total cleansing. And all of this is being acted out. There will be another bowl of water and in this story, and it will be the one that the one who has authority over everything and could have actually stopped all this at a moment's notice sends for to wash his hands of his responsibility. I'm talking, of course, about the bowl of water which Pilate sends for. That's a bowl of water saying, nothing to do with me. Whereas this is a bowl of water which the Son of Man is using, the servant of us all, to say, everything to do with me, completely to do with me, your humanity, your need of cleansing, all to do with me. And when I have washed you, then you will be my messengers to go out and bear the message that I've given you of service to one another. All of that is enclosed in this wonderful passage, which in so many places will be enacted in the liturgy of Maundy Thursday, when we come to the Thursday of this week. So that we give thanks for the fact that this supper is not the Passover, but instead Jesus uses it as an occasion to show our absolute responsibility for one another and our service to one another, particularly when people are in danger or in need or in need of the encouragement of the gift which has been brought, which carries them heart, mind and soul into a different dimension of spirituality, and the gifts of the kingdom of heaven become theirs day by day. The gift of every new day brings that. The scripture is being fulfilled in all sorts of ways, and the disciples are having things done to them which they will never forget, even though they are going to prove inadequate to the occasion through a loss of courage on this particular night when Jesus leads them out, after having said many more things to them. Some of those we shall explore together during these days of Holy Week. But for the moment, the dislocation of time reminds us of that one fact that this evangelist wants to teach us, that as the Passover lambs were being sacrificed in the temple, outside the city, the Lamb of God was being slain, and that sacrifice for the sins of the whole world with arms outstretched is being enacted by the one who, right at the beginning of this gospel, said to the two disciples, who were probably Philip and Andrew, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And now we've come this far through this wonderful fourth gospel, and it's enacted in the time sequence that John and those who follow him in putting this gospel together set out for us, so that that sign will be before us always as we live through this week. So there are certain quite important dates attached to today, and let me start by saying that on this day, on the 11th of April 1755, a London doctor, the son of a doctor as well, called James Parkinson was born. And James Parkinson practices medicine and was a champion of the poor in his area of London, but in 1817 he wrote a very detailed essay on what he called shaking palsy, and he had examined people with it, but he had also observed people with it out in the street, and the detail of that essay is still the focus of James Parkinson's research, which has carried forward. And now his name is given to that shaking palsy, as he called it. He didn't get the cause of it right, but he diagnosed it in great detail, and so it's called Parkinson's disease. And that makes this World Parkinson's Day. Parkinson's disease is something that can attack young and old, and I know this only too well. You've heard me say before that my beloved sister Pauline, who was with us until she died in 2019, in November 2019, before this pandemic began, just before this pandemic began, died quietly in her armchair in the nursing home where she'd been given wonderful care at the Red House Nursing Home by the staff there for 8 years here in Canterbury, near enough to be visited daily. I watched her through 25 years with that wicked disease, which slowly began to eat into not only her confidence, but her ability to be herself. When this was diagnosed, she was the very efficient, very effective PA to the editor of the Guardian newspaper, Alan Rusbridger. And she was his gatekeeper, and also someone who was brave with him to say, Alan, you shouldn't be doing that, you should be doing this. And it was always a wonderful thing to see them together whenever the Rusbridgers came socially in those days to the vicarage in Sherborne or to the place in Hereford, my deanery in Hereford. All of that, one would see the trust that he placed in Pauline and the wonderful dialogue between them and with many others of the Guardian staff at that time. And that confidence in herself was crippled by the slow progress of this disease. I remember her first going to the doctor, and the doctor saying, I think I know what this is. And this was 25 years before she died. And he caused her to walk across the room, and she unknowingly, walking across the long room that he was in, didn't swing her left hand in the way that she did her right. And he said, I'm afraid to say, I believe that this is Parkinson's disease. And then he began to give all kinds of words of comfort and medicines and things which could help and so on. But having been a patron and president of Parkinson's societies in different parts and here in Kent, I know that there are so many different forms of Parkinson's disease which attack people at so many different forms of their life, that on this World Parkinson's Day, there will be people all over the world suffering from this late in life and early in life. Some with that which makes it distinguished as shaking palsy. Pauline never shook, except on certain occasions when she was nervous or fearing, but it was actually simply a debility. And what went first was the expression of joy in her face. It seemed to drain away because of the muscles not being able to make those smiles. But what never went away was her capacity suddenly to spark, especially if a good friend came, or when she was angry about something, and she was a champion of so many causes. So it makes us both weep a bit to think of her on this World Parkinson's Day. But we give thanks for James Parkinson, having at that early stage in 1817 diagnosed this. And we give thanks also for the work of Parkinson's UK in organizing forums and places where people can go online or be together and talk about things worldwide. And when we were able to, each year we had a wonderful Parkinson's Society garden party here, and making sure that there was an ability to bring wheelchairs all over the lawn, that carers were here, and people of all stages of Parkinson's talking to one another. And there's nothing like encouragement from another, especially in good things to go on. Now, as you can see, I could talk a long time about this, and we've other things to think about. But I'd want to give thanks for my sister's huge courage during all those days, because there were terrible times. And so many of those times she must have spent alone in the night. In the end, she saw awful hallucinations and sometimes lovely hallucinations of mother standing at the end of her bed, which is a common thing right at the end of a Parkinson's, a particular type of Parkinson's disease. But God bless her on this particular day as we remember World Parkinson's Day and everything that's being achieved by Parkinson's societies across the world. I wanted to say also, as we're thinking of people who are suffering not just from the pandemic, which of course is still raging in areas of the world and even is on a spike in parts of England too, but so many other things which debilitate humanity. And Jesus, in washing the feet of his disciples, is caring for them and saying, everything to do with me, as opposed to Pilate, nothing to do with me, everything to do with me. And we've been, in this part of Kent, encouraged by a young reporter of Meridian Television, who's been here on several occasions with stories. His name is Kit Bradshaw. And he, on his website and his Twitter, had said last week, with a picture, a lovely picture, "As some of you know, my beautiful, kind, caring husband Lawrence is living with incurable cancer. I'm taking on my first ever marathon in Brighton to try to raise as much money as I can for bowel cancer." And so he had been diagnosed in April 2019 and had every treatment possible, but all treatment options now are exhausted for Lawrence. And Kit was wanting to give encouragement before Lawrence's 31st birthday by raising, by this marathon, his first marathon, £9,000 for Bowel Cancer UK. And the happy story is that he yesterday ran that marathon and has raised £9,200, and it's still open to give to that. Another wonderful cause where we might say, yes, everything to do with me. We'll put the link on for you. But once again, bowel cancer is not confined to those who are older. It can strike at any time, the old and the young, and forums of those that have it, as Kit has said, were very, very encouraging for Lawrence and for Kit as a supporter of the one who is gradually feeling physical powers ebb from them. So all those things, as I think of Paulie and we think of Lawrence this morning, and give thanks for James Parkinson and those who are investigating how better treatments can be there for people with all kinds of cancers, but different kinds of debility. So I'm coming last to my last date, which is of a poet called Christopher Smart. And he is a poet of the 18th century who himself was always eccentric through his life. And this is a year's mind for him. But we remember him most for the fact that when he was committed to what was called in those days a lunatic asylum, confined for, in the beginning, curable lunacy, and then later incurable lunacy, he wrote extraordinary verse. And the verse became more and more focused on God and on Jesus Christ and on biblical imagery. And people had said about him, well, he's quite mad, just as they said about Jesus himself. He is raving, he's mad. But later poets, like Robert Browning, have said, not mad, but one of the greatest poets. Samuel Johnson, who was one of his friends, always said that Kit Smart, this is what they called him, Kit Smart was more sensible and sane in his lunacy than many of the people I know who call themselves sane. And the poet A.E. Housman, when he gave his lecture on poetry as the professor of poetry in 1933 at Oxford, Housman, then, I'm saying Oxford, it was probably Cambridge, but the lecture on poetry which was given said when he was grouping people together who had poetic imagination, he said, one of the foremost is Christopher Smart. He reminds me of William Blake. Well, he does me too. And I'm going to read part of one of his poems. It's a long part, but it's a lovely part. And this was written in his cell at the asylum, but I'm reading not all of it, because it's massive, but I'm reading the text as set by Benjamin Britten in his great anthem, Rejoice in the Lamb, his Opus 30. And this is the full text. It is a text about creation, about creatures, and about exalting God and rejoicing in him. Here we are, and bear with me, because it's a longish poem. Rejoice in God, O ye tongues, give the glory to the Lord and the Lamb. Nations and languages and every creature in which is the breath of life, let man and beast appear before him and magnify his name together. Let Nimrod, the mighty hunter, bind a leopard to the altar and consecrate his spear to the Lord. Let Ishmael dedicate a tiger and give praise for the liberty in which the Lord has let him at large. Let Balaam appear with an ass and bless the Lord his people and his creatures for a reward eternal. Let Daniel come forth with a lion and praise God with all his might through faith in Christ Jesus. Let Ithamar minister with a chamois and bless the name of him that clotheth the naked. Let Jachin with a satyr bless God in the dance, 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 dance. Let David bless with the bear, the beginning of victory to the Lord the perfection of excellence. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah for the heart of God, and from the hand of the artist inimitable, and from the echo of the heavenly harp, in sweetness magnifical and mighty. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. For I will consider my cat, Jeffrey, for he is the servant of the living God, duly and daily serving him. For at the first glance of the glory of God in the east, he worships in his way. For this is done by wreathing his body seven times round with elegant quickness. For he knows that God is his saviour. For God has blessed him in the variety of his movements. For there is nothing sweeter than his peace when at rest. For I am possessed of a cat surpassing in beauty, from whom I take occasion to bless Almighty God. For the mouse is a creature of great personal valour, for this is a true case. Cat takes female mouse. Male mouse will not depart, but stands threatening and daring. If you will let her go, I will engage you, as prodigious a creature as you are. For the mouse is a creature of great personal valour. For the mouse is of an hospitable disposition. For the flowers are great blessings. For the flowers are great blessings. For the flowers have their angels, even the words of God's creation. For the flower glorifies God, and the root parries the adversary. For there is a language of flowers. For the flowers are peculiarly the poetry of Christ. For I am under the same accusation with my Saviour. For they said, he is besides himself. For the officers of the peace are at variance with me, and the watchman smites me with his staff. For the silly fellow is against me, and belongeth neither to me nor to my family. For I am in 12 hardships. But he that was born of the Virgin shall deliver me out of all, shall deliver me out of all. For H is a spirit, and therefore he is God. For K is king, and therefore he is God. For L is love, and therefore he is God. For M is music, and therefore he is God. Therefore he is God. For the instruments are by their rhymes. For the shorm rhymes are lawn, fawn, and the like. For the shorn rhymes are moon, boon, and the like. For the harp rhymes are sing, ring, and the like. For the harp rhymes are ring, string, and the like. For the cymbal rhymes are bell, well, and the like. For the cymbal rhymes are toll, soul, and the like. For the flute rhymes are tooth, youth, and the like. For the flute rhymes are suit, mute, and the like. For the bassoon rhymes are pass, class, and the like. For the dulcimer rhymes are grace, place, and the like. For the clarinet rhymes are clean, seen, and the like. For the trumpet rhymes are sound, bound, and the like. For the trumpet of God is a blessed intelligence, and so are all the instruments in heaven. For God the Father Almighty plays upon the harp of stupendous magnitude and melody. For at that time, malignity ceases, and the devils themselves are at peace. For this time is perceptible to man by a remarkable stillness and serenity of soul. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah for the heart of God, and from the hand of the artist inimitable, and from the echo of the heavenly harp, in sweetness, magnifical and mighty. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That word, hallelujah, is not normally said in Lent, and certainly not in Holy Week, but with Christopher Smart, whom humanity said was beside himself, as they said about our Lord as well, and locked up Smart in a lunatic asylum, as it was called in those days, in great cruelty. And yet this beautiful text of the whole of creation praising God and the music of heaven reaching him in his cell causes us to say hallelujah, for in that way every day is an Easter day, just as for some everyone every day can be a Good Friday in terms of suffering and violence. Yet we remember that in St. John's Gospel, say it again, the Lamb of God was slain outside the city for the sins of the whole world, at the same time as the Passover lambs were being sacrificed ritually in the Holy Temple within the city wall. And those things we remember throughout this Holy Week. Let's say then our prayers together on this day. And we are praying, where's my list, today in the Anglican Communion on this 11th of April for the Diocese of Kuching in the Church of the Province of Southeast Asia. And we are still with the North Downs Team Ministry. Remember, we prayed for Holy Cross Bursted in that team ministry on Saturday morning. And today we are praying for the southern parishes of the North Down team and their priests Mark Pavey and Captain Graham Bibby of the Church Army. And those parishes, I think, are Broomfield, Langley, Leeds, and Ottam. There are many parishes in this North Downs team, and tomorrow we shall go on with the parishes of the Pilgrim's Way. But if I've got it wrong, then the parishes, and there are many of them, as I say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 12 parishes, an awful lot for the clergy of the team to be looking after, and they need much help, I know, from those around them. And we pray, of course, for Justin, our Archbishop, and for Rose, Bishop of Dover, and for Emma, Bishop at Lambeth, on this day. Bring your own prayers, as we say, the collect for this week. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Collect for Lent, which still continues until Good Friday. Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So together, in our different languages across the world, we say the prayer our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Moment now of reflection for you on this Monday of Holy Week.
I don't mind if you got something nice to say about me. I enjoy an accolade like the rest. And you could take my picture and hang it in a gallery of all the who's who. So-and-so's that used to be the best at such and such, it wouldn't matter much. The moonlight feels alright to see your name in lights. We all need an attaboy or attagirl. Of this world, I wanna leave a legacy. How will they remember me? Did I choose to love? Did I point to you enough to make a mark on things? I wanna leave it all for a child of mercy and grace who blessed your name unapologetically.
Remember, Christopher Smart's words, for the flowers are great blessings. For there is a language of flowers, for the flowers are peculiarly the poetry of Christ. Christ who said, consider the lilies of the field. Well, we've thought of many things this morning, and so there are things to think about, and most of all, we think about our responsibility for each other and the way in which the bowl of water, which is so often a sign of washing one's hands of responsibility, on this occasion is the bowl of water which Christ takes to show his responsibility for us. Christ crucified draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, and those whom you would pray for, today and always. Amen. I'm thinking of that bowl of water, and many of you will have been moved by the thought of those with Parkinson's disease. Many of you will have been moved by, of course, people with the pandemic across the world and our need to give to the Ukraine. But at the same time, those two young men and Kit Bradshaw thinking the only thing he can now do for Lawrence to give encouragement and hope, and that's taking the bowl of water and taking responsibility for him. Together, they will raise as much as they possibly can for those who, like Lawrence, are suffering with that appalling bowel cancer. And so if you want to give in that direction, then we put the link on there and the way in which you can yourself take responsibility in a very small way for that too. So it's time to think of our riddle, to have some cheer and amusement at the beginning of the day and see whether we got them or not. And so yesterday, let's find the answers to make sure that although we think we've got them, we are right ourselves because we haven't actually looked. Where are we? Sorry. Right up here. My voice is tender, my waist is slender, and I am often invited to play, yet wherever I go, I must take my bow, otherwise I have nothing to say, what am I? And of course it's a violin. And then 69, here we are. You always follow me, and I am rare, what am I? Well, of course it's the letter U, just as Christopher Smart uses the letter H for Holy Spirit and L for love. The letter U always follows, and I believe that it is Q. It is Q, the letter Q, which always has to have the letter U in English after it. Oh, sorry, let's set two more. Coming to the end of the ones that are easy, and I think by the time we get to Eastertide, we'll try some that are a little bit more difficult. But these two today, see if you can do these. I can be cracked, made, told, and played. What am I? And I begin with a T and end with a T. T is also within me. What am I? I think we've got that one. There's a clue on the table. So let's deal with lost words. And once again, like Christopher Smart, playing with the letters, we come to beautiful things. So let's try and remind ourselves where we were yesterday. We were yesterday with the heron, and today we are with ivy. Here we are. Very short poem, because there are only three letters in ivy, and the acrostic runs down the left-hand side as you look at it. I am ivy, a real high flyer. Via bark and stone, I scale tree and spire. You call me ground cover, I say sky wire. And there's ivy, climbing, or here, drooping down, going in the other direction. We have ivy all over the garden, but here are magnificent collar dove, and also jays, I think, in the ivy, and they're eating the berries of the ivy, because that's lovely fruit for the birds. Well, there is ivy all around the garden, and of course it's completely evergreen, so it's always with us and can be very beautiful indeed. It is ground cover. It crawls along the ground and grows along the ground until it meets something, and then it will begin to climb and climb and climb and flourish. And if it's something that will allow it to do so, like an old tree stump or a supporting pillar, then it will become a completely different kind of plant and look like a great bush. I'm looking at one now, just across the garden, full of shining green leaves and supporting a completely different kind of ecosystem, so that all kinds of creatures and insects and bird life can be in it, and ivy becomes a great sheltering bush at that time. Magnificent the way that different plants can behave in that way. But I think I ought to finish, because he's sitting there so utterly patiently with Christopher Smart's little line of four lines of verse at the end. For I am possessed of a cat surpassing in beauty, from whom I take occasion to bless Almighty God. Thanks be to God that all those signs in St. John's Gospel given us by the Creator give us occasion to bless Almighty God.